How to read research articles. I suggested in the last video, the one on evidence-based policing, that you should try and find research about the topic you're interested in. So, what is academic research? Where do you find it? And how do you read it? What is academic research? Academic journal articles are the published research results of professional researchers who work at universities or other organizations. Sometimes they receive funding from somewhere for their time spent on that research. In some cases, it might be worth looking at that funding source, which they have to declare in the article, so that you can decide for yourself if that funding relationship might have affected the researcher's impartiality and objectivity during the project. For example, I once got really excited about an article which claimed you could reduce behavioral problems in children by giving them omega-3. But then I saw that the researchers got the funding for that piece of work from a company that produces omega-3 oil. Just to be clear, that doesn't necessarily mean that their work is not thorough and objective. But how can I know that for sure? It just caused me not to be completely confident in that research paper's findings, rightly or wrongly, as in my personal opinion, it would have been difficult for the authors of that piece to publish a paper saying the product of the company, who had just paid them a lot of money to do this research, actually has no effect on behavioral outcomes. On the other hand, it is only right that research be done on such products or ideas, so I might be doing that article injustice. What if that oil producer genuinely wanted to check the impact of their oil? They would have to get someone to test it, which is what they did. I'm not sure what the best solution to this dilemma would be. So just check who's funding that research and see if that might change your perception of the impartiality of the piece or not. In most topics related to investigations or policing, there is no product or financial benefactor involved, so you might not actually come across this issue at all. The good thing about published academic research, and really its strength, is that it has been peer-reviewed. A researcher will usually conduct their research and analysis, write up their proposed journal article, and submit it to a particular journal they would like to publish it in. They go through a process of anonymous submission, where the article gets passed on to two or three anonymous peer reviewers, who are also academics in the particular field that the article is about. The article's authors and the selected peer reviewers do not know each other's identity. This is done to ensure that no personal relationships or opinions about people can affect the peer review. The reviewers then go through the proposed article and write down their observations about the methodology, analysis, and conclusions. This is important as it should ensure that no one is able to publish work in a peer-reviewed journal making frivolous claims so they can't back up with their findings. The peer reviewer's task is to call the authors on whether they need to be more cautious in their claims or to make them aware of flaws in their methodology. The comments get passed back to the author, they rework the article and resubmit the amended version. It is reviewed and possibly edited again until the journal accepts the proposed paper. This means that in theory, peer-reviewed research should be reliable and should have been approved in its methodology and conclusions by other non-related researchers in the field. This is why academic research is usually given more credibility than much other work. Wouldn't it be great if politicians were subject to this peer review before they go and make spurious claims that then get regurgitated throughout the media? How can you get academic research? Unfortunately, many academic articles are still published in such a way that you or the organization you work for needs to pay either a fee per article or to subscribe to the publisher or the journal. There is a movement towards publishing academic research for free with open access. The idea is that you already paid through your taxes for universities to conduct the research, so why should you pay again to now read their findings? Also, academics don't get paid by the publishers of the journals, the peer reviewers don't get paid to peer review, so it's only really the publishers who make any money on it, even though the vast majority of articles are now read online rather than in print, which greatly minimizes cost. And in actual fact, academics would like everyone to be able to access their work. Until all of the academic research is accessible for free, you have to find what you can. You could start by going to Google Scholar, which is on www.scholar.google.com. Then just search for the topic you're interested in, as you would in a normal Google search. See what you can find in your search, and if you decide the article is worth reading and keeping, download it as a PDF and build up a folder of relevant research. You can also contact universities and ask them if they have any relevant research that they could send you. Your organization might also have some kind of collaborative relationship with a research organization such as a university, so ask around. The policing community in your country might also have some resources. For example, in the UK, the College of Policing lists and publishes research, as well as providing an online platform for police personnel to communicate with each other. We also have the Knowledge Hub, which is a new way for police colleagues to get together about certain topics of interest and to exchange information. See if you can tap into something like that. Once you identify which researcher tends to publish research you are interested in, you can contact them to see if they would mind sending you other relevant research. And of course, you can contact your nearest or any Society of Evidence-Based Policing to see if they could send you any materials that might be relevant to what you are looking for. How do you read academic research? So, let's look at some articles and talk through the structure. You can see the name of the publication in which the article was published and when it was published. The date can be quite important, as older research, depending on what the topic is, might not be as relevant as more recent research. For example, in the field of forensics or digital media investigations, an article published in 2019 should have more up-to-date and correct information than an article published in, say, 1989. Here you've got the title of the article itself, which can help you decide, when you scroll through a list of articles, whether it is relevant to what you're looking for. Then you have the list of authors. The main author who did most of the work and should know the research best is listed first. The other authors assisted to varying degrees, and it depends on how they worked together. Sometimes one author listed might have just done some reference checking or proofreading, or they might have done all of the statistical analysis. Sometimes a very established and known researcher will be in that list as well. They might have just overseen the piece and perhaps given some advice on it. You can't know just from the author listing. You will usually have one author's email address listed as well, so if you would like to speak to them about the work they did, you can do that. The article also lists the author's affiliation, for example, which university or police force they work for. Then you have the various sections of the article, usually an abstract, an introduction, then the details of the research they're presenting, and a discussion and or conclusion. At the end, you have the reference section. What are references? They are the names and years you see dotted around the article. I mentioned earlier that the purpose of peer review is to prevent anyone from being able to just make spurious claims that are not backed up by fact or research. The names in the article basically refer back to the person who has made that claim before, and that person may either have presented proof or backup for that claim, or they may have just made that claim before the author of the article you're reading right now. In a way, this provides a chain of accountability, and it allows you to follow up with that reference and read that source article, which you will find listed in the reference section, if you want to look at the origin of that claim in more detail. So, the abstract gives a summary of the whole research. What was done, with how many participants, what was measured, and what was found. The abstract helps you decide whether the article is relevant to what you would like to know about and whether you might want to read it or not. The introduction gives a good overview of the field more generally, as it sets the scene of that particular topic of research you're reading about. So this might be a good source of information for you if you want to get a better understanding of the topic overall. For example, if you're reading an article about a particular interviewing technique, the introduction might discuss a historical perspective of how interviewing in the police evolved, which could be very interesting for you to know about. After the introduction, most articles then start describing their research and how they went about it, detailing the setup, analysis, and results of the research. Now, what I will say next might be academically frowned upon, but if you're a practitioner who's not that fussed exactly about the variables and statistical methods used in this article, and you're more interested in the outcome, you might want to skip ahead to the discussion section. The discussion should then summarize the findings and discuss the implications and again refer back to the wider context of this field of research. If you're in a rush or you want to be efficient and scan through several pieces of research, read the title and abstract, decide if you want to read the article, and read at least the discussion or the introduction and discussion of the piece. If you want to understand the methodology better, obviously read the parts in the middle as well. Unfortunately, most academic research is written in such a way that it is not exactly pleasant to read and straightforward to understand. Some academics seem to pride themselves in the fact they use a lot of big and heavy words and sentences, and actually that is counterproductive. So don't be discouraged if what you're reading doesn't really make sense. You won't be alone in thinking that. Even other academics and professionals dislike the way some academic work is written up. It's not always clear and easy to follow, but hopefully you'll be able to get the gist of it. Thank you for watching. I hope you found this content useful. You can get access to each episode's transcript with key learning points, timestamps, and references if you get yourself onto my mailing list. Just go to the main EBP Doctor website on ebpdoctor.com, and on the bottom of each page you will find a sign-up form for notifications of new content. Just enter your first name, your preferred email address, and the type of organization you work for. You will not get any spam. This is just for me to let you know about new content and for you to get access to all the transcripts.